you for having me at your club meeting. It's always a fun thing to do. I've done these all over the Western United States, and this is my favorite. I've done several different presentations on spring creeks and small stream fishing, still water, stuff like that. But my favorite is the spring creeks, and that's the presentation we'll give tonight. And the fly I'm going to tie right now has nothing to do with spring creeks. How many of you subscribe to Fly Tire? Okay, did you, in your recent issue in August, did you see my fly, my article in there?
I haven't read that.
Kind of the first of its kind. It's a dry, articulated, an articulated dry fly. It's a stone fly. It's called the booty shaker, for obvious reasons. The whole idea behind the booty shaker was to get some realistic action in the fly itself when it's on the water, as it floats in the microcurrents and such, and shows, so the abdomen moves, and that was the whole point. And so we'll tie that fly if I can remember how. I haven't tied one of these for a while, so bear with me a little bit. Let's see if I've got something there that's going to do that job. You have to work. Okay. First off, this is a big fly. I'll tie a salmon fly imitation because it's a big fly, easy for you to see while I tie it. And I'll start off here with we'll get rid of that. I don't need it on these big flies. There we go. This is a 55 millimeter fish skull articulated shank, which is used for tying articulated streamers. That's why they designed this shank, was to use for articulated streamers. The idea for this fly came from actually a fellow angler up by where I live, that he found one similar on the internet and tied one up, and I liked the concept. I didn't much like the fly that he tied. Just a lot of different reasons there, but I like the concept because I'd never heard of an articulated dry fly. Anybody ever seen an articulated dry fly?
No.
It's just a new concept, isn't it? We've been doing it with nymphs and streamers for a lot of years now, but not with dry flies. So we're gonna come in here with this bright orange thread. What I want to accentuate here with this thread, this color, is the segmentations with a salmon fly. They're a bright orange, orangish red, yellow orange. It depends on the water and where you're at. And so we want to mimic that a little bit. We're going to put some goose bites on here to simulate split tail on a adult salmon fly. And I like to tie them kind of long, not extremely long, but kind of long, and we'll put one on each side By the way, if you have questions as we go along, just holler. I can tell you right now that the background noise is loud enough that I won't be able to hear you unless you do holler. And so just make sure you let me know if you're having questions as we go along. So we'll tie those in. We're going to tie this with a light body on the bottom, dark on top, which is how most bugs are. Light on bottom, dark on top. We're going to use a salmon-colored 2-millimeter foam and a chocolate-colored 2-millimeter foam. We're going to cut a strip for the bottom. You'll have to excuse me because, well, hello. Look, do you see the guy waving in the back? He's your first Utah Hall of Fame fly fisher, Tom Doxey, from last year. Welcome, Tom. Besides that, he's one of my best buddies. Anyway, y'all, I'm glad you guys came. Okay, so first we're going to... this is what I have to have you excuse me for, because I can't give you exact measurements. In the article, I've got the exact measurements in Fly Tire. And so if you don't have that article and you want a step-by-step of what I'm going to show right now, go buy a Fly Tire. It's still on the shelves, and it's in that book. It's got a Muddler Minnow on the front from Al Beatty. So I'm going to cut this. This is about a quarter-inch wide strip of this 2-millimeter foam. And then the chocolate colored one for the top, I'm gonna cut that just a hair wider. Not much, just a hair. And in my mind, because I have tied so many of these, I kind of know that one's just a little wider than the other. Somebody asked me, why don't you cut those with a razor to get them all even? I said, well, those look pretty even, and when they're on the fly, you can't tell whether they're even or not. So just know that those are the sizes. I always start with a sharp pair of scissors. If you haven't used one of these, how many of you are buying new scissors every year? Usually every year. Why? Because they get dull. How many of you know how to sharpen them? Most don't. And so here I can show you how to sharpen them. Okay? And this is the most invaluable tool you'll have. You'll just love this tool, and I just run it through there and get my scissors razor sharp. You can talk to me about these afterwards, okay? Because I might have some available. Now we're going to take this foam in. By the way, cutting foam with your scissors really dulls them. I don't know if you knew that, but it really dulls them. We're going to cut just a little bit of a point in this. And do the same thing on the chocolate strip. So first off, we're going to start on the bottom. We're gonna put the foam strip facing backwards with that where I cut that, trim that down just a little bit, and I'm just gonna tie that down. And I'm gonna tie that tag end right tight down flat. And then I'm gonna take this back to where the tails start. Now on the top one, we're going to do about the same thing. Sorry, point first. Tie that down. There's a reason I cut the top piece of foam just a little bit bigger, because as you see me as I put this fly together, once again, I want to get that right tight against those tails. When you see me as I put this fly together, I want the top piece to be just a little bit wider over the bottom piece. The reason being is so that it that little edge of that top foam acts like pontoon. and it keeps that fly level in the water. Just some thought that went into this as I was developing this fly. This took me almost 2 years to figure out how I wanted to do this. So now we're going to tie this in increasing size of segments. So we're just going to take that bottom piece of foam, pinch it around there. So I'm just going to take a good tight wrap around that. And 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I'll just go back to the top, leave my thread hanging, go back to the top, and pinch that top piece around the bottom piece. That's going to be good. Yep. Okay, so now do you see where that color comes in? The segmentation that's on a natural with that bright orange thread. So now my thread's just hanging there. What do I do next? Well, I take my thread and take it in between the two layers, just like that, reattach it to the shank, go back to the bottom, repeat the process. Lather, rinse, repeat right here, okay? Lather, rinse, repeat. And that's all we're doing is we're going to go up the shank with these segments. And I don't use any glue at this point on this. You really don't need to, but I will at the end. Take it in between, take it off the back, put it back on the shank. Everybody getting the idea how this works now? Now, if you look real close, you'll see right here why the wider foam, see how it overlaps the foam underneath and gives it that little pontoon effect, so this will stay in the right float in the surface film. Foam will float anyway, but might have got my segments just a little bit off. Let's see how big that's going to be if I do it like that.
You weren't planning on tying that?
No. Let me tie this Spring Creek stuff I'm going to be talking about. That's okay. This is, to me, a very interesting fly because nobody else ties an articulated dry fly. And I'm kind of proud to be able to be the guy that does that and had a decent article in the Fly Tire. Dave Klausmeier, Fly Tire. I sent it, I queried the article with him. Hey, you interested in something like this? By the way, I just tied that off right there. I'm just going to pinch those two pieces together and clip that foam about the same size as that last segment, just like that. And on the top one, I'm going to trim the ears off, just like that. Take those corners and trim them off. See that? On the bottom one, I'm going to do just the opposite. And I'm going to come in and do a little notch. Anyway, I queried Dave Klausmeier about the article, and he says, I'm intrigued. Send it to me. He says, and I'm so intrigued, he says, normally we only have the authors do so many photos step by step. He says, burn up the film. Send me as many step by step photos as you can so that people really understand how to tie this. Well, I get an email one evening, and it's been a couple of months since I heard from Klausmeier, or since I sent it in. I thought, well, maybe he didn't like it. I don't know, but I hadn't heard from him, so I thought, well, maybe I'll keep trying. Because that wasn't my first time I tried to get an article in with Fly Tire. Next thing I know, I get an email from Klaus Meyer, and he says, I just read this, and he says, I'm pretty impressed. He says, is there a way you can, he says, I'll let you know if there's anything I need. And that's just, I just busted off the end of that shank right there. See that? So I don't have the end of that shank on that fly anymore. He says, it looks like it's pretty good. Well, the next morning, I get another email from Klaus Meyer, and he says, I haven't had to touch a thing on this article. He says, if you send me one more like this, you've got carte blanche with Fly Tire Magazine going forward. So I'm pretty excited about that. Hopefully I can get some more stuff that you guys will all be able to read in Fly Tire. Let's see. I was a past fly tying editor for Fly Fisher, which is not Fly Fisherman, it's Fly Fisher, which is membership publication for the Federation of Fly Fishers, but they've changed everything now, and so I don't do that any longer. But I'm still publishing and still getting a little bit of that out there. So you put a drop of super glue right here at the very end. Well, maybe. It's like my end got plugged up. Like my finger's gonna get plugged up too. Okay, little drop of cement right there in the end, just to keep that foam on the shank and those tails where they ought to be. Then I'm gonna put a little bit of glue right here on the front end. So this is the back end. This is the back end of the, this is the abdomen of the booty shaker. Now we're gonna take a number six, because this is a salmon fly size. We're gonna take a number six Gamakatsu, and this is, trust me, if you don't believe that there's a difference in hooks, this doesn't have anything to do with the strength of the hook or anything that like that. This has to do with the shape and size of this hook, so that I have the right size for the thorax of this fly. A bigger hook, it doesn't look right, everything's out of whack. So this size 6 Gamakatsu B10S, which is a stinger hook, which is a trader hook on a streamer, this is the perfect size hook. It's got the right gape here, because of the foam that I'm going to put on it, that it'll still be able to hook fish without that getting in the way. It's a strong hook, and it's got a straight eye, which is something that I really prefer for this fly. We're going to attach the thread, take it right to the back. And this is the articulation point of the program. We'll take some 12-pound Maxima. Just to test, is everybody able to hear me still? I'm still good? Okay. We're going to lay that in so that it's on the top of the hook shank, but off to the far side when I put that first piece down like that. Tie that down and bring it back. Now we'll take the abdomen piece, and you see the eye that I, the from the shank, I think you can see that there, can't you, the eye? We're just gonna take that 12-pound test mono, run it right through there, and bring it right. I'm not right now too concerned as to where it's positioned. What I want, and this is why I have the V-notch in the bottom, is so it rides on the hook right, so that it keeps itself from getting all twisted up, okay? I didn't put the V-notch in there. This fly took a lot of thought, okay? A lot of experiments to try to get it right so it would be the perfect fly in the end, and to me it is. It's just one of those creations that I was just so excited about. So I'm gonna pull this up just a little bit tighter. I want that to rock like that. little bit more. There we go. And then it'll also ride up and down like that. So we'll... Yeah, there we go. Everybody see how that works? That's the beauty. I can show you right now, when that's on the water, that's doing this, okay? And that's the whole point. It shows life. You add that with the legs, the rubber legs that we'll put on here, and the fish really can't resist it. And I just stuck my finger to my pants with the super glue that was wet on my fingernail. So I'm doing good. I got a hole in my thumb and I got my fingernail stuck to my pants. So, okay. Now we're going to come in here. I'm going to take a small piece of the foam here. I'm going to cut just a short little piece like that, and I'm actually going to shave it down to a little bit smaller size like that. And I'm going to tie that in right there. Actually, we'll bring it back a little farther. Tie that in right there, and then we're going to fold that over. Just like that. Now, if you see how I've done that, what this is a ramp that accomplishes two things. Remember, the thought that went into developing this kind of fly, I'm not quite sure how I was able to do it, to be honest with you. It came together. And so, this keeps everything from bumping up, jumping up too far, getting tangled on itself. Okay. Plus, it builds a ramp now for the hair, and I use bleached elk on this. And I have to. You see how long that is? It's some pretty long hair, the bleached elk, and there's a reason, because I need a wing that's going to go from here and actually go back over the back of the abdomen, which is correct for the proportions for a wing. On this big stonefly, so you have to find some fairly long bleached elk hair. By the way, I was on 2 weeks ago. I was on the North Fork of the Clearwater. I don't know if anybody's been up there. It's actually quite a drive above Dworshak Dam, and it truly is true to its name as the Clearwater, just some of the most beautiful country I've ever been in. And the October caddis hatch is going on. It was crazy. And I had tied some up the night before, staying with the mother-in-law in Clarkson, Washington. And this is what I used for the wing on that big number 10 dry fly, that October caddis. And when you combine this color wing with the orange body of an October caddis, then you actually get the right color combination of the fly, the actual fly, because the wings aren't, trust me, the blonde color is the right color to use for a wing on that October caddis, and the fishing was off the hook. And do we have October caddis around here that you guys fish? Anybody? Up in Idaho, where I'm at, southeastern Idaho, we get a few. The Spring Creek I'm going to show you tonight, I've seen them emerge. They actually crawl up on the edge of the moss and stuff, and they emerge like that. And then they dry their wings, and they go skittering off clear across that Spring Creek. And in all the years I've fished it, I've never seen one fish come up and take one of those, not one. This is the first time I ever caught fish on October caddis was on the North Fork of the Clearwater. Okay, so we're gonna try to measure that to get as much wing as we can going over the back. I take two, I don't know if you saw that, two solid wraps around the butts. I want those to stay and not start rolling over the sides, and then I'm going to really tie those down. Here's a trick when you're tying hair wings on. Always just take your thread and just run it through the butts like that. Don't even have to do anything, just run it through the butts like that, and all of a sudden you've not just got one point, but you've got quite a few points where that's hanging onto those hairs. Now we're going to take out the loose ones, okay? About just the right length, might be just a little short, but I think it's okay. It'll look good, I think, when it's done. We'll trim off those butts and quit trimming off the hair. Kelly, you only have so many. I won't take off my hat to prove it. My wife was bragging to me on the way down about how our oldest son has maintained all his hair. He got his grandpa's hair on her side. I got my grandpa's hair on, my great-grandpa's hair on the Glissmeyer Johnson side, and that great-grandpa was a cue ball. So, okay, now we're just gonna go back and get those butts really tied down. You notice I put a little cement on there. Now we're gonna go do just the opposite of how we did it in the back end. Let's see, why is that? Oh, I know why. There we go. And we're gonna cut some strips again, but this is gonna be, this strip that I'll cut now for the bottom of the front is gonna be about as wide as the top of the abdomen. And we'll trim off points there again. I don't go to a point, I can just do a dull point. And then the chocolate one we'll trim even just a little bit wider than that. And we'll do the same thing here with trimming off the dull point. I'm surprised I remember how to tie this so well since I haven't tied one for quite a few months. We'll take this now and we're going to go this direction. We're going to lay it over the front of the hook eye of the fly and tie the narrow end in the back. And I'll just wrap my thread up until I get right tight up against the hook eye. Just like that. And we'll get some wraps and wrap that down. Foam is a wonderful thing. You can do a lot of things with foam. Now we'll take the top piece. We'll do the same thing. Tie that down just like we did along the bottom. This one I can actually hold it down and wrap it just like I don't have to go backwards. Make sure those are straight and parallel with the hook. And we're going to do two segments is all. We're going to do one that's the head, and so it's going to be fairly small. You've seen stoneflies, salmon flies, even the adults, the heads are quite small compared to the rest of the body. Do the same thing we just did to the back, only we're going the opposite direction. Now comes the tricky part, because you want to get the thread back on the hook shank and take it clear back to where the hair butts are tied in. And I like to tuck this piece of foam right up under, let it follow the contour of the actual hook itself, clear back up into the curve, so that I've got something to, so this is all out of the way. Then I can wrap that around with my fingers and take a good solid wrap around that to get that tied down in the right spot. Now you have to watch out the hair that's in the wing. sure you're not getting it all fouled up or tied down wrong. Now we'll take the top piece. And just a minute, because we're going to trim this bottom piece real quick. Now, where I did the, took the ears off of the top piece of the abdomen and the notch out of the bottom piece of the abdomen, here I'm going to take the ears off of the bottom piece of the thorax, just like that. Now you can see the reason. That's part of the thing that helps keep the fly from getting tangled in itself. So now we'll take the top piece, pull that down, and wrap that down. I'll actually cut this piece off square, about the same length as that segment that I just tied. Cut it off square. Now here I'm going to do, I'm going to take the notch out. And the reason being is if you've ever seen the wing pads of salmon flies, you'll notice that they have something that looks similar to that. And that's all that is. Plus that helps the wing, the hair wing, to be able to stand up the right way without that piece of foam obstructing that. So, almost done. Last thing to do, we've got the right colored legs. Black and orange, variegated rubber legs. And I know that there's some purists here that'll go, you've got to have three legs on each side. And I'm okay with that if you'd like to do that, but I'll let you spend the extra hour doing that. We're going to put two on each side, and we're going to put them right here, which is just the right spot for them. Now comes the fun part, because now you could use your whip finisher. I don't use a whip finisher at all, not ever. I do a double half hitch hand whip. Now here's the beauty of having sharp scissors. You notice I didn't shut those. All I did was touch the thread. So let's just get our legs the length that we want them. Make sure they're in the right position. Pull those up like that. Oops, I'm missing one out of four. Trim those. Now, last thing I want to do is just put a drop of super glue right there where those legs are tied in. It serves to tie in the legs, plus it glues those two pieces of foam together. So right there, you have KG's Booty Shaker Stone, which is a dry articulated stone fly. You see what happens on the water, wiggles back and forth. Great pattern. If you can ask the question, does it work? I wouldn't have written the article and wouldn't be tying still if it didn't, because I tested it a lot. So.
I got one question.
Yes.
Where did you put the battery? Where did you put the battery in there?
I'll let you figure that one out.
Don't be able to shut up.
So, what do you think of that concept, a articulated dry fly?
Very cool.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. The next one coming out in Fly Tire will actually be a hopper, an articulated hopper. So, watch for that next spring, okay? So, there's that one. We good with that? Did I get to do okay, Dave?
Yeah, keep rolling, bro.
We're going to tie a fly that is not mine, but it's integral to what we're going to be talking about tonight, about fishing spring creeks, some new methods for fishing spring creeks. How many of you have ever fished a spring creek? Oh, about half. How many of you who have not would like to? Somebody holler out why it is you haven't if you've not fished a spring creek.
Still new.
Okay, new.
It's tough.
It's what?
It's tough.
It's tough? Yeah, it is pretty tough. We're going to teach you a method that might simplify that for you a little bit. Bill, you were in my class, I think, at the Wasatch Show, or in and out of my class. I did a class this last spring at the Wasatch Show. Didn't have a whole lot of turnout. And that's okay. I'm not famous. Right next door, I think I had Mike Lawson talking about fishing somewhere. I can't even remember what it was. What's that?
I think he did the Yellowstone area.
But he was during the same time I was, and there's no competing with that. So.
But I had several people come out after the class that raved. So.
About which one?
Yours.
Thank you. I know they raved about Mike's, but once you see this, I hope you'll spread the word, and we can get the word out there. Maybe I can do it again this next year at the expo. Okay. I'm going to tie what's called a parasol emerger. How many of you have seen one of those before? A couple of you. Okay. How many of you have fished them before? Wow. Okay. I use medium to light dun macrame yarn for this. It's nylon, but it's a little finer than the stuff you'll find in the fly shops that you, the stuff you get for parasols or for dry fly posts and that kind of thing. It's a little bit finer texture, and so that's why I use it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take 7 strands that came out of this macrame piece that I found at the DI, unwound it, now I got these pieces. So I'm going to take my 22 caliber dubbing brush. And I'm going to brush that out, brush out those strands so they're all lined up together and not twisted around each other. And it looks like that. See how nice and neat those are? Now we'll take some 6-pound Maxima Ultra Green. 6-pound is 2X in the Maxima. We're going to take that and we'll take the yarn like that and lay it right over the top. See how I've done that? Can you see that?
You're above the camera.
Oh, sorry. Okay, can you see how I've done that? I've laid the yarn over the top of the 2X. I'm going to take that and pull the. Come on. The 2X stuff together like that, and then I'll pull the macrame yarn over like that. Now, can you see that? How I've done that? The macrame yarn's folded over top of the 2X material, or the 2X material's folded over the top of the macrame yarn. But you see I'm holding both ends of the 2X in one hand, both sides of the macrame in the other hand. And what I'll do now is I'll take this, come on, lost it again. I want to get rid of all those macrame pieces that are floating. We'll take this and we'll spin that like that. Let me get it in the other hand. It's easier to work. So we're just going to spin that macrame back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, until it gets really tight there at the end. And then I'm going to spin that about six times. And once I've done that, I'm going to take the tag end. Now imagine with me, if you will, this is a hook eye, the macrame. This is your tippet material. You're going to tie an improved clinch knot. That's all we're going to do here in that macrame is, so we're going to go through that V shape right there, we're going to go through it. Now, if I was to stop there, tighten it up, that would be a clinch knot, right? Clinch knot doesn't work on this. You got to have the improved, so we'll fold it over one more time, take it through, get it wet, pull it tight, and then I'm actually going to pull on that quite tightly with my fingernails to get it right up tight against that macrame material. Trim the tag end. Now, here's another reason to have sharp scissors with this job, is because you want to cut this and you want to do it in one shot. So now, I've got that all, and you can see the hinge effect. You don't want the hinge effect. Can you see the V?
Yes.
And that's where the nylon tippet material goes around it and holds it together. You don't want that V, and so you got to get rid of that. So we're going to take that and put it back down on my vise stand, and we're going to brush that out again. And we're going to keep spinning that as we brush that out. What I'm trying to do is get all those fibers so they're not lined up in that V shape from where the nylon material wrapped around it. Now you see it's kind of like a crafter's, about a third size of a crafter's, what do they call them when the pom-pom, thank you. I knew one of the ladies would know that. So now, you're gonna spin that together real tight again. Grab it just with the tips of my thumb and finger, like that. And I'm going to cut that off to where it's about a quarter of an inch long. Once again, really sharp scissors are required because you just want one snip. Now you're going to spin it around. If you notice there's a couple of few loose ends or pointy ends, we're just going to spin it around and get that cut off. So now we've got a parasol puff that's going to go onto a fly. Okay? I'll make these up dozens at a time. Cut that off, and so I've just got that parasol puff. Now we're going to go and tie my favorite pattern that I use for the parasol emerger, and that would be a pheasant tail.
Kelly?
Yeah.
Do you vary the colors on those puffs at all?
I don't. Now, in the past, did everybody hear the question? Do I vary the colors on the puffs at all? I've done pink ones, I've done orange ones, I've done white ones, I've done black ones, I've done blue ones. I had an entomologist friend of mine say when fish look up and they see blue, they won't think anything of it. Well, the problem is reflection off the surface of the water makes it disappear too from up above, so blue doesn't work.
Would it benefit you at all to use UV by any chance?
Say again?
Would it benefit you at all to use UV by any chance?
UV?
Ultraviolet?
No, I don't believe so. The fish would probably see it better, but I don't. Here's the deal. For me, this color, I can put out my full line. I put out a 90-foot fly line with leader on it, and I can see this in the surface, on the surface, okay? That's just me. That's my eyes. Some guys can see white better, but you get a sparkly day, guess what? The white's gone. Now, on a sparkly day, if you had black, sometimes you can see that a little better. But this is my go-to color for... Sorry, I keep going too high, don't I? This is my go-to color for me to be able to see it. And I varied it to the orange, the pinks, the bright colors. I can't see them. This one I can see at distance. And that's why. So I have experimented with them. I also use 2X for this post. There's a reason for that. There's guys that have done these with tying thread. This isn't a new concept, the dandelion fly. few different guys have had iterations of this that they've done. This is one that was done by Leeson and Schulmeier. And they got in a whole bunch of hot water when they published the article because they said it was an original type pattern, which it was for them. This tying it this way was original for them. But somebody talked about the dandelion and some other flies and called them liars, and they had to do a retraction and say, sorry, we understand. But the whole point was this was their original idea. The post, though, was critical. If you use lighter, it flops over. It doesn't stand upright, and it wraps around the leader. If you use stiffer, you can't tie it on some of the hooks, the smaller hooks that you tie. The 2X works perfect, keeps it standing up the way it's supposed to and oriented the way it's supposed to. So now we're going to tie this in a... Did that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we're going to tie this in a pheasant tail pattern. I'm going to use a Dairiki 125 in a size 14. I'm just going to use black thread for this. Remember the sharp scissors. Okay. We'll take some pheasant tails first. We'll get about five or six. Everybody get a chance to see the articulated booty shaker. Anybody else need to see it? We good? Okay. Now, if you saw it, what did you think?
Loved it.
It's amazing.
Thanks. Okay, so five or six pheasant tail fibers. These are dyed yellow. I like this color combination for pheasant tails. So I'm going to tie that in. I don't tie long tails. You know, the original pheasant tail nymph looked nothing like what we tie today. So I don't call this anything original to me either, but this is a really great pattern. Pheasant tail nymphs will catch fish under trout and other fish under most circumstances most of the time. And this tie that I do, I'll show you the next fly that I'll tie will be my also not my original. You'll see some of my original flies besides the booty shaker. You'll see some of my original flies in the presentation that we tie for Spring Creeks. But the other one is just a pheasant tail that I've adapted with some different materials and tying methods. So now we're going to take the parasol puff.
What did you just tie in there?
Oh, sorry. I tied in a piece of chartreuse wire for a wire rib over the pheasant tail material. Somebody's going to ask, why chartreuse?
What size?
This is a small size.
Okay.
You don't need bigger for a size 14 hook. Small size is just right. In fact, I can use a small size on a 16 hook. You go below a 16, you want to get extra small. Don't use the heavier brassy size unless you're getting 12 or above. Okay. So, why chartreuse? I catch more fish with chartreuse. I use it in a lot of my patterns. You'll see it. By the way, I've got some cards up here, recipe cards with detailed recipes and pictures, so you know what they're supposed to look like when you're done. You're welcome to come and get these tonight and take those with you, okay? But now, we're going to tie a mayfly. A mayfly, when it emerges, it's going to come up and it's going to angle about like that. Yeah, we're just. Can everybody see that? We're going to angle about just like that. We're going to hit their thorax against the surface film, and they're going to split out of that thorax and emerge through the surface film. As they split out of that thorax, crawl up on top, dry their wings, fly away if a fish doesn't eat them. A caddis fly is going to do about the same thing, but a midge is going to come up about this orientation. A little bit of an angle. In fact, some midges come up and cup and attach at both ends, but they'll still emerge out of their head And that's what it is. And that's, so if I'm tying a midge pattern, I'm going to tie this parasol puff right behind the hook eye at just about an angle like that, so it orients that nymph right like that under the surface film. But if it's a mayfly like this is, I'm going to tie it right where the abdomen and the thorax meet, right behind the wing case, so that it orients this fly the right way in the surface film. That's what we're going to do here, is since I'm going to tie a mayfly, a pheasant tail nymph, we're going to tie that about a quarter of an inch, maybe 3/8 of an inch long, and then tie that down clear back to where the pheasant tails were tied in. I'm going to trim that off. Now, what I'll do is I'll grab the wire, the pheasant tails, and I'll wrap over the stub of the parasol, and now I'm going to wrap over the top of those down a few wraps past where I tied in the pheasant tails, and there's a reason for that. How many of you have seen the pheasant tails break off when you've used them? It's because when you tie those in tight around one spot, you've tied them in tight, you've pinched them, and eventually they're going to break. So by doing what I just did, and I've tied all my materials in, then I wrap my thread back just a little bit over top. I've actually formed a sheath over all that, and now I've protected those pheasant tails. Good trick and tip to know when you're tying any type of tails like that, okay? So, next thing, I'm not going to stand up the parasol yet. I got some other things I've got to do here. First, we want to wrap our pheasant tails. As you notice, I've got this fancy rotary vise that serves to let me turn the fly around so I can see how I've done on the bottom. And I don't usually use it to wrap materials, so that's just my choice. And I'll wrap those all the way up to the hook eye. Now we'll take the wire and rib that about 6 or 7 times, and we'll stop that right behind where the parasol post is. Take my thread right back there, catch that wire underneath, and then I'll wrap my thread around the wire almost clear up to the hook eye. That keeps things even, so you don't have big bumps and bulges in certain areas. Okay, so now we need to put something in there for a wing case. And in this case, even though they probably won't see the flash except in the reflection, the surface, we'll take some. By the way, if you're still using pearl mylar for flashbacks, you need to change. This is just my personal opinion. This is called a Mirage tinsel made by UTC in an opal color. It's actually a mirror finish. I don't know if you can see that. It's a lot shinier than your pearl. This is great stuff, and I can do a lot of different stuff with this material. We're going to do this as a wing case. So we'll tie that right down on top of the thorax area, and take my thread right back to where the wing post is. Now, a little tricked with some peacock curl. I'll just grab a couple. We'll grab those by the tips. And when I grab those by the tips, then I'll sweep everything back so they stand out straight off of the shank there of the feather fiber. And then I'll cut off about the first inch to inch and a half. Those are really brittle up there at the end. I've seen a lot of guys that tie their peacock still in by the butts, and that's the stiffest part. And I think they think that that's going to make it stronger by doing that. But what it really does is make it weaker, because those butts are so stiff, they'll break. And even if you don't do anything, if you tie them in by the tips, they'll still break a lot easier if you don't do what I'm going to show you. So I'm just going to lay those to the side of the thorax area, wrap my thread back to where the flashback starts. Now I'm going to take my two pieces of hurl, my single piece of thread, and take my hackle pliers. I like these electronics grabbers for hackle pliers. I've never had a pair of English hackle pliers that have held consistently. They either slide out or they break off or whatever. So I'm going to take those, and I got the two hurls and the one piece of thread, and I'm going to grab all of those together just like that. Okay? Now, first thing I'm going to do is trim off those butts of the peacock. Now, I'll hold on to my hackle pliers while I stretch the thread so I can have enough to come back, and I'm going to reattach that back up here on the hook shank. So now I've got two pieces of thread, two peacock hurls, and I'm going to spin those. There's some ways, you know, guys will just wrap that around the thread by hand. I'm going to spin those counterclockwise. Why counterclockwise? Because as you go over the hook shank, as you wrap stuff, that's the way it spins. You don't want it getting looser. You want it staying tight. And so by doing it counterclockwise, that stays tight. So now I'm going to take one wrap round, one wrap behind that first one. And on this, because it's such a small space because of all the materials, I'm just going to take that one last wrap. So I've only got three wraps of that doubled over hurl. But this hurl is bomb proof, okay? A tooth catches that, and they're not going to break or split or whatever. It's bomb proof, it really is. It's there to stay, because it's basically what you've formed is a peacock chenille, natural peacock chenille. And so it's a great way to do that. Now comes one of my favorite things that I learned years ago, and I can't tell you where I learned it, but I learned it. And so I'm going to share it with you tonight. And this is how to put legs on nymphs. Really, really good looking legs on nymphs. This is, by the way, just an India hen saddle. And when you're using a hen saddle, they're rounded feathers. And I'm just going to grab one of those that's got some, they're usually mottled, and so they got some good color, look like insects, and I'll grab that by the very tip, and I'll sweep everything back beyond that, so that I've got an even number top and bottom there, kind of an X right there. Can everybody see that? Is that clear? And where that's at, I don't have an even number. Thank you. I need to look in the camera and I can, there we go. There, that looks better, doesn't it?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just going to snip that out. I don't need it anymore. Now I'll grab it by the stem and I will sweep forward about a dozen or so on each side. So once again, I've got an even number top and bottom. So I got bare stem right in the middle. And now what I've got is X marks the spot, and where that X is, where that bare stem is, I'm going to lay that right behind the hook eye, and I'll take one, two soft wraps. I don't want to pull this hard yet because we're going to adjust the hen saddle. What I'll do is I'll put my thumb on top, I'll grab the stem with my right hand, and while I pull with my right hand, I'll guide that with my left thumb to forward. And what I'm trying to accomplish here is some legs. I split out that one piece so that I'd have that V shape in there. Then I'll pull my flashback over the top through that V notch that I achieved by cutting out the tip of that feather. Two good solid wraps. I'll even pull hard on that. You see how that flashback got real shiny and tight? That's by putting a couple of good hard wraps and then pulling on that flashback so it really pulls it under that thread and pulls it tight. So now we're going to lift everything up. I'm going to take one, two wraps. Now this is an important step. I'll just take one back over. Because how many of you have got to the end of the fly and you're well, the reason I do the legs like this, you see them? Kind of cool, huh? Okay, equal amount on each side. See, we used to, you take a clump off of a feather and you tie those in one side, and then you take another clump off a feather and tie those on the other side, and one side's too long and one side has more than the other. And well, in this way, you know, you've got just about exactly the same amount on each side, and they're pretty much the same length on each side. But especially doing it the other way, if you come to this point and you bump your thread like that, what happens? It all comes apart, doesn't it? That's why I lifted everything up and put two wraps right there. Those are safety wraps, and those keep everything in place so they don't come up when you pop it like that. So now, I took two wraps over the top. I'm going to take my scissors in there real tight, clip off the rest of that feather. I haven't trimmed my wing case yet. We're going to finish this off with three sets of double half hitches, form a small head with it. Now, all you need to do with this is touch it with your scissors and it's gone. Now we'll get anytime I put Mylar on a under thread, you think you've done the thread wraps really tight, you get to the fishing it and the thread wraps get wet and they stretch, and how many of you had the Mylar do this? And you got that flashback standing up straight. Always, always, always just put a little drop of cement right there on those threads. It keeps that Mylar where it ought to be for as long as it ought to be there, until too many fish tear the fly apart. Now, we just position that back up where it ought to be. Little angle there. I pull my wings down for legs. What do you think? That's a parasol emerger.